banners just like that.
Okay. And then when we're looking at Chicago teachers and the state additional payment, does Chicago maintain their 90% funded ratio? Right now, that runs about $10 to $12 million a year. What happens in this bill? Is it we're locked in at that $10-12 million to keep it 9%, or could we all be surprised and it might be $50 million next year?
Representative, I'm glad you asked that question, because there's a couple of reasons for the inclusion of that provision in the bill. To begin with, the Chicago school system is reporting a huge operating deficit going into the next school year. And they've talked with the Chicago Teachers Union about suspending a scheduled pay raise of 4%, which when you add in step and ladder, would take some people to 5.5%. To date, the Chicago Teachers Union has refused to open the contract. When we get closer to the scheduled date for opening school, they may change their view, but today it's a hard position against opening the contract. What the school system is proposing is that the scheduled payments for the next 3 years be changed, and that the Board of Education would pay the ordinary cost for 3 years. And that would provide that in 2011, normal cost would be $187 million, and the following year, $192 million, and the following year, $196 million. And I believe that there would be a difference of about $400 million. So in terms of their current budget problem and the difficulty of opening school, this provision would provide about $400 million to help them balance their budget and open the school. And the second reason that this is included, and I want everybody to understand I'm being as nice and pleasant as I always am, right? There was a bill before the General Assembly. It was sponsored by Representative Monique Davis, House Bill 4582. It was called on March 18th. And it was a pretty simple bill. It simply would say that the state would pay into the Chicago Teachers Retirement System 20% of what it would pay into the teachers' retirement system. And fair enough, Chicago is about 20% of the student population in the state. You know that school districts outside of Chicago pay almost nothing into the teachers' retirement system. They pay something, but close to nothing. In Chicago, major payments from the local real estate tax into the Chicago system. And so this bill would say, let's be fair, give Chicago 20% of what TRS would get. That bill failed. There were 42 yes votes and 71 no. And I have the roll call here. We can go down the names. There's no need for that. This would say, okay, if the state doesn't want to at least give us 20% of what it gives TRS, let us work with our local real estate tax money. We recognize that this would require a change in the payment schedule. We recognize that. We recognize that that's not what people are thinking in terms of doing nowadays, but they're up against a real tough situation, and it's all concerned with local real estate tax money. And again, I don't have the figures in front of me, but the state of Illinois contributes a very small amount of money to the Chicago Teachers Retirement System. At the same time, that it provides maybe 95% of the money that goes into TRS for school districts outside the city of Chicago. And so the request here is, let us work with our local money to try and close this projected deficit at the Chicago.
So you're saying this is gonna come out of real estate taxes and there won't be any more monies coming out of the GRF to fund this part of it?
Well, there's some that comes out of GRF today, and I would expect that that would continue. But it's a small amount of money compared to what goes to TRS.
I guess what I'm doing on section 17-127, it's on page 28 of your bill, is what we're really wanting, some of that is, what's that get additional to maintain that 90% funding ratio for the retirements? How much more is that going to cost the state of Illinois? Yeah, and it's percentage of payroll.
I don't have those figures. I'm sure that little bit that the state pays may increase slightly, but
we'll probably need that answer to that. Probably
the bigger, the bigger side will be the restarting of the clock, so it's going to take longer to get to 90%, but that's going to be 40 years from now.
That's what we're reading now is we got to maintain that 90%.
No, we're not at the 90% yet, so we're not going to get to 90%.
So if we take this holiday, how's that affect?
It's going to take longer. But so where they would have been at 90% in the year 2045, it's going to go to 2060. So the state would pay for 15 more years.
Okay.
40 years from now.
I guess what we're driving at, John, is if we're going to do the holidays, we're going to skip some payments. Why is the section 17-127 still active in the bill? Why didn't we deal with that? It's on page 28. Why didn't we put something in there to exactly how the skip holidays could affect that?
Excuse me, Representative Poe, while they're looking for the answer, I'd like to recognize Representative Acevedo for a vote.
Yes.
And he'd like to be recorded as a yes. Thank you.
One other thing I have here from state employees. If you're hired, let's say this all happens and it's signed within a week, and if you're hired in anywhere in the state after that, you will be under this form.
That'd be my understanding.
What happens right now, and I think the only one might be set up that way, is to ask me, and were those employees have been working with the state 2 or 3 months, and they don't actually have the probation in, but they have been working with the state for 3 months. Are they grandfathered in? Are they okay on the old system, or are we going to go backwards on those? An intent would work here.
I want to get a lawyer's opinion. My guess is that they're vested. They're on the payroll, right? Yes, they're
right
on the payroll. And the way the court decisions have gone, why they're vested?
Okay, that was a clarification. We get an answer to that, and Mr. Chairman, we can go on. One last question. This whole thing, after we do this and all these 13 different retirement systems, what's the savings? What monies are you projected in your 45-year benefits to get to our 90%? How many billions of dollars is this going to help?
Obviously, we got to get an actuarial run, but it should be well over $100 billion of savings.
That there alone probably will get us to our 90% then by 2045.
We have to get to 90%.
Yeah.
By 2045. That's not changing.
Okay. So, will we have some of those numbers we've asked about before we vote on this on the House floor?
I don't think we'll have reports from actuaries. We can give you the numbers we've worked with. I'm sure you've been working with numbers also. And I think John said $100 billion. Just remember what Ed Dirksen used to say. You know,
we'll continue with Representative McCullough. If you want to say when the proponents are finished with their questions, we're going to have a quick question for Mr. Zine, followed by a quick statement by Mr. Malaro, and then I would ask Mr. Preckwinkle to please organize the witnesses who oppose the legislation. So when we get to